side, Carolina
home. Tucked away in the sounds of northeastern North Carolina, in Currituck County, you'll find Knott's Island. That's where Bob and I went this week, to visit the island and to talk with a very special person that was born and raised there, Mr. Roy White. There are two ways to get to Knott's Island. One is by ferry, coming from Currituck. Bob and I took that route, about a 45 to 50 minute trip. Now, before you take the ferry, be sure to check with the ferry division and make sure you have the right schedule. The other way is to come in from the north, from Virginia, on a two-lane highway. When you get to the island, you'll find a lot of small farms. There's also a small wine industry on the island and a wonderful wildlife preserve. Along the road, you'll see many beautiful sights, including the historic Knott's Island United Methodist Church. We'll visit with well-known decoy carver Roy White when we come back. We're with Mr. Roy White in his decoy shop here on Knott's Island. Roy, thanks for having us by today.
Glad to have you.
Tell me a little bit about your life a long, long time ago when you were first a boy here on Knott's Island.
Well, I was born and grew up on Knott's Island in 1918. My first year, my daddy built this farm in Hunting Lodge in 1922, and we moved down to this place from up the Simpson's Neck. When I was between four and five, I remember going to Norfolk from here on the old boat. The only way we could get all this on those days was through an old corduroy road that had across the marsh causeway.
What's a corduroy road?
Corduroy road is first cut off of a tree, they call them punchings, slabs, and they laid them down. They used to cut them 16-foot lanes. They cut them in 8-foot lanes and put two rows across and then hauled dirt in the middle for the horse to walk on. That's before the canal got on the causeway. So I've been across that road with Daddy, carried turkeys to Norfolk to sell. Then all the way across the marsh and come into a yard, a Peel Bounce's yard, and he had to open the gate to get in because he had cattle, then open the gate to get back out. And then they hit the same road as runs all the way into Norfolk now, Princess Anne Road. It took maybe a bit of a horse and cart. We left about 5 or 6 o'clock at night, and the horse just walked all night, and we stepped in the cart, and brother and I were with him, Edmund, and get Norfolk next morning about 5 or 6. And then the hucksters, they call them hucksters, used to come around and buy produce and turkeys and all. And most likely he'd sell his turkeys by 7 anyway, his turkeys would be gone. Then Daddy would go shopping and give Evan and myself a quarter apiece, and we'd go to the place called Bird Theater and get a hot dog for a dime and a drink for a nickel and 10 cents to go into movies. And that's where we spent our time at. And that night, afternoon, we come start back home. That was in the good old days. No such thing as automobile on this island. First car come on this island in 1925. Charlie Capps brought it over here in 1922 model, T-Ford open car. In them days, you know, all the roads on this island were horse cart roads in which you went back and forward. And they left the store. I was standing on the store porch. When he left going south, and the car was bobbing back and forward, and pretty soon it turned over on the side. And both of them had, them days, everybody, all on Saturday, that was on Saturday, everybody wore hard straw hats, you know, the high brim, hard brims. So they picked their hats up and got out and picked the car up and set on the wheels and kept on going.
Now, you said that you sold turkeys. I understand you also made a living back in those days as a hunting guide, too.
When
you
oh, got yeah, a hunting guide. But first off, one of the ways we made a living was on the beach. It was free on those days. And my daddy would kept about 50 hogs over every year. And I mean, kept about six sires, eight sires over there and get about 50 pigs every year. And he sold those. He raised cattle in the field, about 10 of those every year. And then the winter months when they come getting, well, up to about October, and it would start getting ready for hunting. Then we'd get all the old decoys out and repaint some of them, rehead some of them, and get ready for hunting and open the first of November. And then Daddy had pretty well had men for the whole hunting season, which was 3 months. There were New Jersey and New York and Norfolk and North Carolina. We used to have some men like Governor Marsh from North Carolina used to come down. I hope in New Jersey had H.B. Hill Coal Lumber Company. They brought a bunch down. Different ones would come down for a week. How they stayed in that house out of a glove, I don't know, because they had no bathrooms in those days. They didn't have electricity. But Daddy had gas lights put in, gas plant put in for lights and everything. And he also, you could cook on that and everything, carbide lights. Today, if you try to explain to a person what those were, you could never do it because I don't think anybody ever uses those anymore. Those days, this bay was just full of ducks. When my daddy left his land when I was growing up, of a morning, you couldn't start your motor to sunrise in those days. It was kind of low. But they started up motors and went to their blind. I could tell which blind they went to by the streak in the grass. What they had was 4-horsepower motor boats, is what he had, just an inboard. And the little wheel would cut the grass up every year through it. But the grass was so thick, there's sea chickens and all would be walking onto it all over the bay. And the ducks were so thick that when, like I say, when they hit that bay, the ducks would raise up. And you couldn't even see the sun. The sun had to be coming up now when they started the motor. And they'd blacken the whole sky those days. Ducks won everything. And of course, then the limit was 25 ducks. And I believe it was 15 geese by that time. And most days, any kind of weather at all, they killed their limit. I really didn't start guiding in 1937. And I only did it then for 2 years, because in 39 I went in the service. But those days I made my own decoys. My dad said, if you'll make your rig, I can get you men for pretty near the whole year. So I quit school and went to guiding.
So that's how you got started as a hunting guide, but also that's how you got started making decoys. When you use Roy White's name anywhere now, they say, oh, the man that makes the decoys from Knott's Island. Yeah. You're pretty popular.
I made decoys all my life. Not study, because you know, when I was working, of course, naturally, I was working up Virginia Beach, and you know, that time, make decoys in. Once in a while, we make maybe one, like an Egerton or something. But we were in 1978, I started making these decorative birds, which you see, little small birds. And I've been making those ever since, and I do a lot of shows. I've done as high as 29 shows a year with those birds.
There's more to come with Roy White in just a moment. So in addition to making working decoys, you've also had a lot of success in making shorebirds and other birds from this area.
Shorebirds, little decorative shorebirds, standing mostly, and things that I can sell pretty reasonable in the shows. I started doing that in 1978, and first show I took was in the Aztec Wildlife Refuge. They had a show in the refuge. And then they got their own Easter Decoy Festival show, so I did that for 20 years. So I've had good luck with these birds. I've sold probably, my wife one time, he had an interview and she said, he's been sold over 1 million birds. I said, good man, I hope the tax man didn't hear you.
but you've won some awards for your birds too.
Oh yeah, I have over 200 ribbons. Wow. All from honorable mentions on up, the best of show.
So when you were making the working decoys, that's where you began to learn the techniques for making the decoys that you've been winning the ribbons for?
Four bags I can remember. In the fall of the year, even my brother and I, the dad would put us repairing his ducks. So the head was missing, we'd make a head and put onto it. I don't remember how good the heads were, but we made heads and put on to each one of them, and we repainted some of them, put new duck cord, they call it in those days, for the string that goes to them, and make sure they had weights on, tied right, because when you put them out there, a lot of people didn't tie their decoys right, and you see them drifting. And they weren't worth nothing in those days. If one went to drift, if the wind was blowing and you had men out there, you'd let it go on and drift. You wouldn't interfere with the duck hunting, because by the time you leave your boat, take your boat out of the blind, it'd worry time a bunch of ducks would come out. So the decoys weren't worth nothing, so you just let them drift off. One time, Dad put on a couple more rigs, and he needs more decoys, and that was in 34, and Lumber Dudley down on the beach. He found out that he had some decoys for sale, so we went down there. And Daddy knew Lumber good, Lumber Dudley, and he said to Lumber, he said, what would you take for 100 of those decoys? And he had a little house there, and they were full of decoys. And Lumber said, if you were going, he said, I know you're going to pick them, pick all the best ones. Said, if you're going to pick them, I'm charge you 50 cents a piece for them. But he said, if you let me throw them to you, straight, I'll sell them to you for 25 cents. Daddy said, start throwing. And so he took 200 of them. Instead of 100, he got them high price, so he took 200. 80 of them were Lee Dudley's. And there was, but Lee Dudley's was a small and didn't show up very good on the water because it was round bottom and had weight onto it, and it was kind of a flat bird. Well, Daddy put those in the little house, duck house he had, in the corner, and never did tie them. Never did use them, because he only needed 100 for two rigs, 50 to rig. And later years, the house burnt down. They don't have it get burnt down, no electricity or nothing, but all at once he come home, he said, it's on fire, and burn up 800 decoys.
Now, 25 cent, 50 cent back then, but today, and in the past few years, those decoys have been worth hundreds of dollars, haven't they?
Well, what Lee does is that he had in the corner and never used. Today, they're probably worth about $50,000 each.
My gracious.
I've seen some of the auctions have been selling for $60,000.
Wow.
I think Mars Warmer, not long ago, he sold one, I believe he said 20-something thousand. They're worth a lot of money. A piece of wood for $20,000 is a lot of money for a whole piece of wood.
It is. How about the techniques that you use for making the decoys today that you win your awards with? What do you do that makes your decoys special?
Well, most of my decoys are made by hand. That's what I think makes it special. But I do use a Fordham tool, which is a little Dremel like sander. And I also have for making decoys, I have a 6-inch belt sander to sand the bodies off on the decoys. I still make a lot of decoys.
Do you have some way that you study the decoys to make sure you get the detail like the real bird?
If I was a decorative bird, I do, yeah. I had to go by the book, because you got to put all the ever spot onto the duck head. You got to put it there. So I have a good many books on decoys. And more on decoys than I do on the shorebirds. The shorebirds, mostly, a lot of times I go on the beach and just lay there and watch those shorebirds. So that's why I mostly make shorebirds that's on the beach, or ones I see in the marshes over here. Yellowlegs is a marsh bird, and I make that a lot of those. In fact, I got a name for yellowleg.
How about the ducks and the geese? They're not as plentiful now as they used to be.
Ducks are completely gone in our bay. I don't think I've seen 200 ducks last year in the whole bay. The swan don't stay in the bay. The reason for it is the boats. The boats run this bay all night and all day. Well, if a duck can't sit someplace and feed and rest, he's not going to stay there. They have a few swan up in the refuge up in Virginia Beach area, Back Bay area, and this year, but not very many. But most all the swan, when they come down now, they go straight south, like Manamuskeek and those places, Peon in there.
Now, when you go over to the beach today, how much has it changed from when you were a boy?
Well, it's all entirely changed. When I was a boy, when we went across the bay, the bay is 2 miles wide, and it was all push pole in those days. You know, you pushed a boat across, or a sail. And then we hit the beach landing, we called it, and then we had 1 mile of marsh. A lot of mosquitoes. Boy, you had to carry a burlap bag with you and flirt to keep the mosquitoes off of you. And then we had that 1 mile of beach, sandy beach, not a thing onto it, but bald sand. No trees, no bushes, nothing. back in those days, we could just take a blanket over there and lay down and throw a fishing pole out in the ocean and sit down and see if you catch a fish.
Is there any story that you remember or stories from the old days when you were hunting out there and fishing out there that just really stand out that you might want to share with us?
Oh yeah, I've been out there. Well, last time I was with my daddy, and that was in 1946. And we tied in Norbert Ansel's blind up the Captain's Creek. And that morning it started snowing. That was about in December. I come home for Christmas, what it was. And started a little light snow, and pretty soon the redhead started flying. And my dad was a good shot, but I couldn't hit nothing. So we shot until the gun run hot. And my brother come by in a boat, and he said, at that time he done killed way over our limit. He said, let me get in the blind and kill this red. So he got in the blind, him and Lister Cartwright. We picked up 101 redheads. Those days don't happen no more.
Well, Roy, I appreciate you spending a few minutes and telling us a little bit about how it used to be here on Knott's Island in Currituck a long time ago, living and hunting, and about your decoy making. You're a pretty famous decoy maker around here.
Well, I got a little bit of a name because I've been doing it so long, you know.
Next, Roy will show us some of his older decoys, as well as some old decoys made by other carvers from the area.
Roy, you got a big collection of old decoys here, some of which I understand you and your family made and some other folks made.
Right.
Tell us a little bit about this goose, for example.
This goose, in the early 20s, they outlawed the live decoys. So then that year, in 1927, my daddy said, well, I got to have some decoys, so I'm going to make some. So what he did, he went to the store, ate them in the store, and kept getting all the old orange crates. The oranges in those days come in select crates. And in 1937, he made this select goose and covered it with canvas. And that was the beginning of the canvas geese on my phone. After this one, next year, they went to the regular canvas geese,
mm-hmm.
which is the, there's no number of canvas and wire and wood. This was made in the 30s too.
How about that coot decoy that's sitting right over there to your right? Where did that one come from?
This is Lister Cartwright's, made in the 40, late 30, I think about 39. This coot, Cartwright made right many of them, and in the Albemarle Museum, I noticed the paper the other day that they were going to sell all the old decoys, except they're going to keep Lister Cartwright's coot, which is this coot.
How about this duck decoy I'm holding? Who made that?
This decoy I made in the 30s myself. I made this in actually 1935.
So you use that decoy for hunting?
Yeah, I see the shot holes.
Oh yeah, I see them. Yeah, how about that?
Yeah, I'm a very good shot, so when I shot it, hit the decoys.
Well, you shoot these old decoys, they stayed together. The new ones, the day you shoot them, they sink.
This duck here, actually, I made it for a Scarborough on the beach. And the only reason all my decoys got burnt that I made in those days. But when Mr. Scarborough died, his wife brought me this decoy back, because I made 10 for Mr. Scarborough when he was in the Coast Guard. And this is one of them. And so this bird was made in the 30s.
He's beautiful, Roy.
And of course, this swan. Look at this one now. This swan was made on the beach. Maggie White's club. Cummy White made it. And this is an old beach swan. Put on the weight on the bottom is the off of the old wreck ship. And he made a lot of decoys. Cummy White did. But this is the only swan, as far as I can find out, that he ever made.
A special thank you to Roy White for sharing part of his life here on Knott's Island. And thank you for watching. May God bless you richly.
My heart will always be Carolina. Although across this country I may roam, my heart home. I
went away one day to find my fortune.